Hello students, my name is Shayan Mitra, faculty member of Department of Electronics of Communication Engineering of Greater Kolkata College of Engineering and Management, GIS Group. Today's topic, that is the continuation of the previous lecture, is memory organization. In this lecture, we will be talking about DMA and different kind of architecture. So let's get started with the memory mapping. Subject name embedded system. Code name is EC703A, lecture number 7. Memory maps. So in the figure 1 or figure A, we have a Princeton memory organization. And the second figure, that is the figure B, we have a Harvard memory organization. Both, as the name of this, both of this organization is different, memory organization has different name as well as some very different architecture. Very few small minute details have been changed in both the memory organization. Now if you take a very close look on the Princeton memory organization, what we have here is, if we take a closer look of the memory mapping, is that here we have vectors and pointers. There is the program memory as well as data memory addresses between 00 to FFF. As we already know that memory organization, the addresses will be in the hexadecimal format. Now this is the program memory. It has been already been said, this is the program memory, this is the data memory, and this is the program memory. Sorry. This is the program memory, this is the data memory, and these are the vectors and pointers. As you have already discussed, the functionalities or the basic objective of vectors and pointers are of which they used to point the next address location of the next program instruction that is going to be fetched. The next program location's address has been pointed out, that is going to be fetched by the processor. So these are the vectors and pointers, these are the program memory as well as data memory, these are the program memory, these are the data memory. This is the read write, this is the data bus, this is the address bus. Data memory has input data as well as output data. Now if you take a close look on the data memory, this is the data memory, here it is, and it has input data as well as output data. So it will be connected to the data bus and with the address bus. Program and data control signals, these are the program and data control signals. As I've already discussed about the control signals, that control signals is specific signals that has been sent by after decoding the program instruction. The control signals usually sent to the memory and the different unit of the, it has been sent to the different unit of the embedded system and the memory. So according to the control signals they work according to it, and all the functionalities will be controlled by those control signals. Now here it is from VIU, this latch, these decoders. Program memory has boot up program, functions, routines and tasks. This has already been discussed, that program memory always has the boot up program, because after switching on any kind of embedded system, any kind of processor, any kind of machine which has embedded system design, we need to active the whole machine. So that's why, for that reason, the program memory always has the boot up program, functions and routine and tasks that is required to activate the total system. This is the Princeton memory organization. Now if we take a very close look on the Harvard memory organization, what was this? it has the same thing. It's a program memory. We have program memory and we have data memory. The basic difference in the memory mapping of Princeton and Harvard memory organization is that in case of Princeton memory organization, program memory and the data memory are not segmented. The program memory is here, data memory is here, and program memory is again there, and these are the stacks. Now in case of Harvard memory organization, the program memory are being attached in a specific four blocks or in a specific four blocks. It's not a four blocks, a continuous block, and then there is a segment, there is a space, and after that the data memory addresses are being organized. So there is a segment in case of Harvard memory organization. Both are separated by a segment, a space segment. Now program code, this is program code read and write will be there, address bus will be there, the read and write both the, and for that reason, for so we have to fed the control signals to both the program memory address and the data memory addresses. So that's why this signal is there, the read write data. The data bus will be fed to both, the address bus will be fed to both, and these are the control signals that is fed to the data memory, read and write data will be fed to the vectors pointers, the control signals. So there is the basic difference between Princeton and Harvard memory organization. Let's go to the next slide. The memory maps. Memory areas needed in the case of Princeton and Harvard architecture are different, and as shown, and that what we have already discussed. Vectors and pointers, variables, program segments and memory blocks for data and stacks have different address in the program Princeton memory architecture. Now if we take a look again on the Princeton memory architecture, what we have there is this. This is the Princeton memory architecture, and what we have already discussed, and what is been said here is the vectors, pointers, variables, program segments and memory blocks for data and stacks have different address in the program. This has a program memory, these all have a different address. Stack, vector, pointers has a different address for the Princeton memory architecture. Program segments and memory blocks for data and stacks have separate sets of address in Harvard architecture. That I have already discussed, that program segments and memory blocks for data and stacks have separate sets of address in Harvard architecture. Control signals and read-write instruction are also separate. If you take a look on that also, here. Because of this segmentation, the read-write instruction will fed to both of them. The address will be there. These are, that's why both have different address, separate sets of address in case of Harvard architecture, and in case of Princeton memory architecture, the vectors, pointers, variables, program segments, and memory blocks for data and stacks have different address in the program. But in case of Harvard architecture, program segments and memory blocks for data and stacks have separate sets of address. Control signals and read-write instruction are also separate. All are different because there is a segment between the memory block and for the program memory and the data memory in case of Harvard architecture. So all those required control signals, program segment, all the control signals, read-write instruction need to be fed to both of the segment. But in case of Princeton, that is not required, but they have a different address in the program, but they are not two different different address memory is not required, or instruction set is not required, separate sets of address is not required. Designer must remember that if main memory is of Harvard architecture, program memory map will be separate. That's what we have already discussed. So let's go to the next slide. Map to show the program and data allocation of the addresses to ROM, RAM, EEPROM or flash in the system. For program input data ROM, the address bar is from this to this. This is a 7FF up to. For static variables of program and program stack, we have a RAM. Program from program and input data, we need a ROM, read-only memory. For static variables of program and program stack, because the RAM will need to be accessible during the program run. So the static variables of program and program stack will be stored in the RAM, and the address will be this 1000 to 100 FF. Memory map for an embedded system. That's an example. There is no need to. For current balance and other output data, electrically erasable programmable ROM will be assigned. And this is the address limit from this to this. For other output data, after the processing, after the process data is need to be stored somewhere, so it will be stored in the EPROM. Now we'll discuss the direct memory access. A DMA is required when a multi-byte data set or a burst of data or a block of data is to be transferred between the external device and the system or two systems. It means, it is self-explanatory, that when a multi-byte data set or a burst of data or a block of data, a chunk of data is need to be transferred between the external device and system or two system, the direct memory access is required. A device facilitates DMA transfer with a processing element, single purpose processor, and that device is called DMAC, DMA controller. Three modes of DMA operations are there. Single transfer at a time and then release of the hold on the system bus. Burst transfer at a time and then release of the hold on the system bus. A burst may be of a few KB. A bulk transfer and then release of the hold on the system bus after the transfer is completed. So there are three modes of DMA controller. So now we'll discuss about the DMA controller's modes. Now we're talking about DMA controller. Data transfer occurs efficiently between input-output device and system memory with the least processor intervention using DMAC. This is the significance of DMAC. If we read it again, the data transfer occurs efficiently between input-output device and the system memory with least processor intervention using DMAC. It means the direct memory access controller is basically used to speed up the transfer of data from one system to another system or one system to another external device. Now, if we use a DMA controller, it will reduce the intervention of processor in that kind of functionalities. To transfer a data, we don't need to take the permission, or there's no need to set aside a different program instruction to perform the data transfer operation. That's why the DMA controller has been introduced. DMAC provide memory access to multiple channels. Direct memory access controller provide memory access to multiple channels. That's the important factor. It means through multiple channels we can access memory, we can retrieve data, or we can fetch different kind of program instructions or addresses or data. Specifically, different kind of data can be accessed through multiple channels using DMAC. Separate set of registers for programming each channel. Separate interrupt signals in the case of multi-channel DMAC. Provides DMA action from system memories and two or more input-output devices. Separate set of registers for programming each channel. Separate interrupt signals in the case of multi-channel DMAC. Suppose we have a multi-channel DMAC, so we need data of one channel the first time, but we have data on the both channels. To navigate that data flow, we need that kind of interrupt signal which will help us with the data flow through different channels. It provides DMA action from system memories and two or more input-output devices. DMA controller with the buses and control signals in between. Figure shows the buses and control signals between processor, memory, DMAC and the data transferring input output device. Now if you take a close look, that this is a DMA controller, this is the RAM, this is the processor, a port with one or set of addresses, input output bus, devices to send or receive from RAM. So this is the DMA controller. This is the bus acknowledgement, this is the bus hold request. So using the processor we can hold or acknowledge the bus availability request. This is the DMA controller. Now, yes. Now from the RAM we can, using the control signal, we can fetch or retrieve data from here, and through that we can send it to the external device, or we can retrieve or fetch data from the external device into the system, into the embedded system. This DMA controller is basically the controlling unit which use the acknowledgement and different kind of control signals to reduce, to fast the communication of data for two different system or for another external device without using the interruption of the basic processor. So this is the processor and this is the DMA controller. DMA controller is used with the acknowledgement signal. It can fetch this data from the RAM through the address bus or the data bus, the address bus and data bus. These are the from decoder ports. This is the port, yes, through which the external device is connected. Let's go to the next slide. DMA controller execution. DMA proceeds without the CPU intervening except at the start for a DMAC program and initializing and at the end. It means these two control signals that has been used is basically for the start of the DMA controller and the end of a DMA controller. In between, all the operation that has been done, all the data transfer which occurred, it could be received or it could be sent from external device or into the external device, all the control will be in the hand of DMA controller. Only the initialization and the ending both need to be acknowledged by the processor. Other than that, all the function will be controlled by all the functions are performed by DMA controller. At the end, whenever a DMA request by external device is made to the DMAC, the CPU is requested using interrupt signal, the DMA transfer by a DMAC at the start to initiate the DMA, and at the end to notify using interrupt signal the end of the DMA by DMAC. Only at the beginning, when any external device will send a DMA request, at that stage when the DMA controller is initializing, the CPU is requested with the initializing signal or the interrupt signal. If his processor sends that signal, the DMA will start, and at the end the same kind of signal will be transferred back and forth from the CPU to end the DMA controller's operation. Let's go to the next slide. Interfacing processor, memories and input output device. Interconnections for a simple bus structure has three sets of signals: data, address and control signals. A system bus interfacing design is according to the timing diagrams of a processor signal, speed and word length for instruction and data. Interfacing of processor, memory and input output devices using memory system bus. Now if you take a closed loop, this is the processor, we have ROM, we have RAM. Now this is the data bus, this is the address bus and this is the control bus. That's why it has been said that interconnection for a simple bus structure has three sets of signals: data, address and control signals. A system bus interfacing design is according to the timing diagram of processor signal. This is a very important line that a system bus interfacing design is according to the timing diagram of a processor signals, speed and word length for instruction and data. It means it the timing the, according to the timing diagram of processor signals and speed, the system bus interfacing design will be designed. So this should be, it's a customized design. That's the basic point. Interfacing of processor, memory and input output devices using memory system bus. Interfacing of processor, memory and input output devices. Now this is the input output device, this is the processor, these are the memories. Now this is the interfacing structure. This is the data bus with which the ROM is connected. It will be connected to the processor, it will be connected to the RAM. Now in case of address bus, is also connected to the processor, it also connected to the ROM, it also connected to the RAM. In the third line, this is a control bus, it connected to the processor and with ROM and with RAM. Now input-output ports, if you take a look at the input-output ports and devices through which the instrument device is connected to the data bus and control bus and the address bus. Through these buses, important data has been used, or different kind of control signals will be transferred to the input-output device. Let's go to the next slide. Time division multiplex address and data bits for the memories. TDM is different time slots. Time division multiplex is means different time slots, there is a different sets of the signals. It means at different time, different kind of data will be, or different kind of data, different signals will be sent through the channel. Address signals during one time slot and data bus signals in another time slot. That is the basic, that's why it is called multiplexed. It is mean multi means more than one, and plexed mean it has been organized side by side manner. That's why it's called time division. That's why the time division multiplex. It has been structured side by side using the time division process. It means at a single time that channel will not send address signal and data bus signal at the same time. It will send address signal at a specific one and in a one time slot, and data bus and address signal will be on one time slot and data bus signal in another time. Interfacing circuit for demultiplexing of the buses uses a control signal. When we are sending some signals from one device to another device, that specific device which received all those data, that interfacing circuit for the demultiplexing will be placed on that specific external device. Control signal is at address latch enable ALE in 8051, address stroke in H68HC11. These are the example of different kind. There are different kind of control signals. And address valid ADV in 8019. So in different processor, there are different kind of specific control signals are there. And there are, in case of one processor, there could be many different kind of control signals. ALE or AAC or ADV demultiplexes the address and data buses to the devices. And that are what we have already discussed. Interfacing circuit using latch and decoders. ALE for a latching that ALE is for latching the address. PSNE, program stores enable, for program memory read using address data buses. Each chip of the memory or port that connects the processor has a separate chip select input from a decoder. Decoder is a circuit which has appropriate signals of the address bus at the input and control circuit signals to generate corresponding chip select control signals for each device. This is the definition of decoder. And if we go to this, ALE for latching the address, program stored enabled for program memory read using address data bus. It means this specific PSA, program stored enabled, basically if this signal for program memory read using address data buses, that it uses the according to using this PSEN control signal, it basically read the data from the database using the address. Each chip of the memory or port that connects the processor has a separate chip select input from a decoder. Decoder is a circuit which has appropriate signals of the address bus at the input and control circuit signals to generate corresponding chip select control signals for each device and ports. So summary of the interfacing circuits are consist of latches, decoders and demultiplexer, designed as per available control signals and timing diagrams of the bus signals. Circuit connects all the units, processor, memory and the input output device through the system bus. All the buses, data bus, address bus, using that all the circuit connects all the units, processor, memory and the input output device. It's a all well connected system. Also called, that's why it's called blue circuit, used as it joins the device and memory with the system bus and processor. All the elements, all the components of our embedded system has been connected through the all the circuitries. That is known as blue circuit. And can be designed using generic array logic or field programmable gate array. That has been, the acronym of that is FPGA. So this is the summary of our interfacing circuit. So, and this is the memory system. Yes, this is the last slide is about memory system bus and input output bus interconnection in a bus structure. And this is the basic configuration. There will be many different segments we have to will discuss on the next lecture about the bus, input output buses. Now this is the very basic structure. There is a processor, there is a RAM, ROM, there is a system bus, the memory bus, data bus, control bus and address bus are there. It has been showed in this manner. Now it has been connected to the input output bus controller, for example PCI or USB, and this is the, just like we have a USB, that a pen drive is an input, it's an external device. We connect that, this is the USB port, this in here there is a, suppose there is a pen drive is there in a computer. So this is the whole structure. So thank you. Up to this we'll stop today's, we'll end this today's lecture. From next day we'll be describing the different kind of buses of embedded system. Thank you.